suppose a student in the university gets up and tells Pushkala class, she is a better report on English. She says, sir, your grammar is wrong, madam. What will happen to you? He will become an outstanding student. And this student, Albert Einstein in 1925, became an outstanding physicist for the next 30 years till the old man died. And in 1955, when the old man died, Werner Heisenberg, the student, gets the Nobel Prize, the only Nobel Prize for truth in science. Nobody has seen the electron, but so many people got Nobel Prize for saying what the electron is like. J.J. Thomson, 1907, Cavendish Institute in Cambridge, gets the Nobel Prize for saying that electrons are particles. 30 years later, his own son, J.G. Thomson, gets the Nobel Prize for saying they're waves. Schrodinger says they're vehicles, waves and Schrodinger, he gets Nobel Prize. And Werner Heisenberg says they are nothing because they have not seen them. He also gets that. If you become B.Sc., you don't see God. By the time you are M.Sc., you don't come into the school because God's pictures are there, Mahaswami's pictures are there. Because God doesn't exist in science. But they have not analyzed why God didn't exist in science. I'll tell you the story. Science is an enterprise created by man when he had enough to eat. Up until that time, nobody thought of science because the next meal, Indian supper was the Yangtze Valley peasants. They were worried about the weather, whether they will get a crop next time or not. And you don't know when you get a meal. And not knowing when you don't get your meal is the biggest risk factor for a heart disease. You didn't know that. There is a study done in London, our big industry. The managing director hardly gets a heart attack, but the floor worker gets a heart attack. The manager is assured of his next meal, nothing to worry. But the floor worker is not aware because he loses his job, he doesn't know when he eats. His children will have to sleep empty stomach. Lot of women in the village die of heart attacks, but that's called there's some curse of the goddess or something like that. Because they are not labeled, they don't come to a five-star hospital for angiogram. So there, but what happens is, what kills them is not knowing when their child gets the next meal. Husband earns, drinks, eats, comes home empty-handed. The woman doesn't mind sleeping empty stomach. Nothing happens. No, if you probably sleep empty stomach, you live longer. Nothing. And you all think, you know, if I don't eat, then acid will come. Misconceptions from water. Empty stomach cannot secrete any acid. You require some food there to secrete acid. Whatever food it is. And if you have a calcium containing food, you get plenty of acid because calcium stimulates the cells to secrete acid. And what the best calcium containing poison that you take is a white poison called milk, M-I-L-K. The biggest poison. How that? She is a good patient. Actually, she is the wisest person in that house. All other doctors give her tablet at the top of hat, and she puts it in the waste paper basket. She reminds me of that wise husband whose wife was every day bothering him to go to the doctor for a checkup. This man said, I am well, honey, why do you want to be? No, 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 you don't know. You know, I saw that bunting there. Are you, you know, there are 1 in 6 people in Chennai are diabetic. Are you one? And he gets right. And she took him to the doctor. So the doctor gave a laundry list of medicines after examining and doing about 750 tests. And he painfully went to the pharmacist and bought all that. And then the wife was worried because so much of money is wasted. Then he comes home and quietly goes to his room. Wife was watching. He throws it down the drain in the sink. She was mad. She said, what the hell do you mean? You spent about 25,000 rupees and now you're selling. He said, honey, listen. If I didn't go to the doctor, how does the doctor eat? If I don't go to the pharmacist, how does he survive? And if I don't throw it, how do I survive? So in Amma, Rumba wise. And the tablet is up here. She's so wise, I tell you. I think she must be a professor in the medical college because her son or son-in-law or somebody was pestering her to take that statin, one of the biggest poisons that he said, to lower her cholesterol. What did she do? She was taking one on a Monday and one on a Thursday. Very wise woman. I told her, now permanently throw it into the waste paper basket. So, where are we now? We came to science. So, what I was going to tell you is that we don't have a science base in medicine of the Western type. Though we call it a scientific evidence-based medicine. Where is the evidence? I don't know. So it is evidence-burdened medicine. Evidence can be created. And evidence is so false that we have what is called RCT, randomized control trial. We take 10 people here, 10 people here, give a tablet, no tablet, and then say this is better than this. Now these 10 people are different. They are not two molecules, the chemistry laboratory where you can do an RCT. They are totally different human beings. Their consciousness is different, which is 50% of yourself is the consciousness, your mind. And your minds are so different, I tell you. You may look alike. God only knows what's going on in your mind. Mind can be a big, dynamite, wanting to destroy this whole world. You may be, what is his name? That fellow who wants to destroy the whole world. He's no more. Saddam Hussein, no, let's say Saddam. But you may be Gandhi, nobody knows. And you don't know what Gandhi is, what goes on in Gandhi's mind, how he is scheming to get Jawaharlal Nehru as the Prime Minister. See, outside it's all, everybody looks nice. But nobody can go deep into his mind. If one can go deep into one's mind, one will never have any problems in life because mind will adjust everything. You're so tranquil all the time. Look at a child. It's a scientist and the healthiest person in this universe. Do you know why? It smiles at everyone. Have you seen a small child? It is estimated to smile about 1,000 times in a day. Just go back and see some of your friendly people. How many times they smile? You smile 500 to 1,000 times a day, your heart is so varying, called sinus arrhythmia. It can't be broken at all. It's so strong. Child's heart is so strong. You come, you go to school. The child's mind is called manas. Manas is a dark room with a hole outside. And the child is looking through the hole. The child's mind is looking through the hole. BMID goes that way. Fine. Ramesh goes that way. Anybody goes there, it's fine. It doesn't make any difference. Now it goes to school. Then it's called buddhi. What is buddhi? Past experience. So the teacher says, this ass is called BMI, and this God is called Ramesh. It makes a distinction. So next time in the buddhi, a BMI goes and says, oh, a bad man. No smile. Ramesh was smile. There, then it next goes to the next level. After getting all these bad things from school, it goes to the next level where ego comes in. That's called chitta. Manas, buddhi, chitta. Chitta, I. I don't like BMI. See, problem starts there. That is why Patanjali said, chitta, vritti, nirodha, yoga. Yoga is not kusti. Kusti is thiram sukham asanam. For pain in the head, dead leg, and you can do kusti. But what is important is, yoga is just simply becoming a good human being. Lot of people come to me and say, sir, I do yoga every day as you said, but I am not cured. He does yoga, sits there and says om om for 1 hour. 23 hours he is saying how to destroy others, how to kill myself. What yoga is? A yogi, all the 24 hours, all the minutes of the hours and all the seconds of the minutes, he must be only thinking of the well of others. How to improve the world? How do I help someone else to be happy? How do I prevent myself destroying others' happiness? You know, it's very difficult, but it's difficult. Like for example, yesterday I tell you what happened. This happened. I was going for a lecture. They had sent a car. This taxi fellow was very funny. He didn't know where the lecture was. How do I know? Anyway, he stopped at a red light. And there was a beggar asking for money. And I felt sorry for this beggar because he was an advanced leprosy. No fingers at all. He was genuine. So I wanted to give him some money, but I didn't have small change. So I asked this driver, can you lend me 10 rupees? No, immediately sir, Ulkurta. Then I gave it to that fellow. I went, lectured and forgot about the 10 rupees. Came back and never paid. Now I had my shower at all and I was about to sleep, then I suddenly remembered, oh my god, I have not paid that for 10 rupees. After all, for a driver, 10 rupees is very big money. I didn't have the driver's number.
But I had the number of the man who had invited me for a lecture, so I called him, woke him up, and then told him, you know, I'm sorry, I did a mistake. I owe 10 rupees to the driver. How can I reach it to him? Sir, you don't worry. By tomorrow morning, his 10 rupees will be given to him. Then I slept. Otherwise, I won't get sleep at all. Now, why is this? Because you think inside. This is called inner engineering. Please do your inner engineering and you'll be very happy. Because if we always judge others with a very strict standard, when it comes to you, you compromise the standards. You see? When you judge others, you become one of the most upright judges like Justice Venkatachalai or somebody. When it comes to you, you become somebody, Balakrishna or someone, so you have a different standard altogether. This is where our problem is. We always think we are right, and we always think others are wrong. This mentality is something that destroys your peace of mind. When you think, how do I help another person, you get plenty of peace of mind. When you get something, you are not happy, you want to get more. But when you give something to somebody, you are very happy because you could give. That is why Ayurveda says, Data, be a giver. Then Samaha, you know, you always have this idea. Suppose Ramesh is a big man. If you see your fever with a low man, hey, look at. When I was a dean of the medical school, a lot of these girls, you know, fall in love with their classmates. So they come to me and say, sir, you must be knowing this boy, sir. Do you, he is my boyfriend, do you think I can marry him? Then I tell a young lady, my idea of him is 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. So what it has between 5 p.m. and 9 a.m., I have no idea. That's a longer period of time. But I will give you a simple test. Take your boyfriend for a cup of tea in a big restaurant at 9 a.m. And then, as he enters the restaurant, the owner comes, because the medical student is there, can I wait? He got a lot of money, you know, most of them. And then the restaurant owner will come and say, hi doctor, come, come. And then see how the boy responds to the doctor. Hello, miss, how are you, sir? And you shake hands. Then you go and sit to the table. The table is little dirty. Says, hey boy, come here, clean it. Don't marry the boy. Don't marry the boy. He must be samaha. He must have the same attitude to us. Because after all, we all came together here. Not together, but alike. And we are going also same way. You didn't have anything. You think I have this. Whose is that? You are just a trustee. It was someone else's yesterday, it will be someone else's tomorrow. In between it is yours. Now you can't say it is mine. It's not yours. So you should never have that attachment. You must have what I call detached attachment. Then it is yours. Okay, you look after it. Don't throw it on the road. Keep it in a cupboard. But then you don't know. A lot of people say, oh, I do this, I do that, I protect it from a killer. Don't give your children any money because they will have to live on their own. If you give money, they will be lazy, they won't do anything. That's why Jesus said, it is with the sweat of his brow that he shall eat bread and all days of his life. I tell you the pleasure of earning your own money and spending it. I tell you, so nice, so nice. And if you spend someone else's money, I call it as very dangerous thing, addictive. Opium, you know opium? You know opium? Huh? Opium, other people's money. It's like opium, O-P-I-E-Q-U-M. It's so intoxicating. That's why these politicians, these bankers, these industrialists, they are all having all kinds of diseases because they are addicted to opium. You say, what is this? Corruption, corruption. What is corruption? Greed, isn't it? Greed kills. Greed is the biggest killer. Krodhar, Shokar, Bhaira, Ayasa, Virudhana Bhojana, Tapodala. Tapodala means not doing tapas, not doing anything. Sedentary living. Katva, Amlakshara, Varana, Tishno, Shruti, Rakta, Vishar, Rakove. All diseases come because of the mind. Where is the mind? Never mind. So, help is happiness. Happiness is giving. Did you understand that? Love is happiness. What is love? If love is what you give away, love is what comes back each day. Christine, an American poet, has wrote so beautiful lines. So I would change it like, you know, Christine also wrote, who has seen the wind? Who has seen the wind? Neither you nor I. But when the trees bend and dance, the wind is passing by. I have changed it. Who has seen God? Neither you nor I. Who has seen electron? Neither you nor I. But electron is seen because I am talking because you are hearing because of the electrons. But electron can't be seen. God can't be seen. They can't be revealed. Now God was excluded from science because the initial stages, the scientists were not greed. They didn't have greed for money. Like, you know, Galileo, Archimedes, they didn't patent their products. They didn't sell them. They didn't have. But the church at that time, it was about the 12th century. After the 12th century, churches became universities. They thought these scientists will do experiments. And once they do experiments and can't get the experiment reward, they will not really against God. So we should guard now. So some of the scientists were really tortured by the religious fanatic. So the scientists, younger generation scientists, developed a subconscious avarice towards science. I mean, towards God. That is why God was excluded from the science. That is why in the old idea of the world view of Newton and Einstein, what is called space view, where God was excluded. But now the quantum physics tells us it's not the, just the space. Not the fastest thing is the speed of light. Fastest thing is the speed of the mind, Manovega, which is there in Sanatana Dharma, Manovega. And this is now called in quantum physics teleportation. And quantum non-locality, you know. It's very, very classical non-locality, which was not there in science at all. Today, Radin, a physicist, has done experiments to show. You know the two-slit experiment in physics, some of you might have heard about it. How the electrons go through the two slits. Now, Radin has shown, your mind can make this electron go through a particular hole you want it to go. Can you believe that? So, what I was trying to tell you is, we have come to a stage of quantum healing, where you can heal any disease with thought. With thought. Just imagine. If you can make an electron go through a particular hole of your choice, why can't you make an electron in your own body heal your own self? Nobody thinks about it. And quantum consciousness is the mind. So the mind is the most powerful doctor. And as long as the mind doesn't monkey around, you know. And mind is in the universe. My mind and your mind are a part of the universal consciousness, which is called individual consciousness. And when individual consciousness comes out, the universal consciousness remains whole and the individual consciousness becomes whole. Purna Madha, Purna Vidaha. Beautiful thought. Chemistry teacher must have told you, if you take hydrogen molecule from water, what will be left is base and oxygen. So you can't use hydrogen from water to run your car because a car will have to have a new engine every 3 months. But today, quantum scientists like Gustav Roy have now seen, if you put a little salt into water in a test tube and then pass radio waves through that, atomic hydrogen will come out and you can light it with a torch and a not torch, matchstick, and the water will be burning. And very interestingly, the water doesn't get go down. If you have a wick in the oil goes down, no, water doesn't go down. Because you are taking only atomic hydrogen, which is whole, water is whole. And Rusu, I wrote in the paper, I learned this from my grandmother who taught me Purna Madha Purna Vidaha. He is from a Kulin Brahmin family in Bengal. And he went, you know, in 7 years he has been in America, married an American lady, converted to Christianity, but still does Homa in his house. Still performs the puja and in his house. And his wife, she is a Christian. And he still goes to the church and performs as a priest and stands in for a, in Pentecostal church, anybody can be a priest. And he does. He has done 100 marriages in the universe. 100 marriages, free. People who don't have money for a marriage, he and his wife will join together. He will be the priest, she will be the assistant. And then they will give 10 people dinner in their house, all free from their salary. Interesting. Now, Rustam Rai wrote, this atomic hydrogen will be the future. Fascinating thing. This is the only laboratory where if you give him a pencil, he will give you a diamond. After all, if you know the material things, both are carbon. And carbon loosely becomes pencil, tightly becomes diamond. See how fascinating this world is. So friends, let us come back. Our idea is to be healthy, to be happy, and to be useful to society. Paropakarartham shariram. Now I'll tell you why. You thought you are born because your mother and father and your genes and this and that. This gene business is a big business. Genes, then cord blood, and then stem cells, this blah 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 blah. This has been grown out of science nearly 40 years ago. Genes don't have any power because in the genome, you only have 23,000 genes in the human males, of humans, but 2.5 trillion germ genes, 2.5 trillion germ genes. So what is your father and mother's contribution to you? 23,000 divided by 2.5 trillion. I can't calculate that. Any good mathematics? It'll be probably 1 in a billion chance of your having something, except probably the face and the color or something like that. But your parents are the germs. Every planet is initially inhabited by germs. You go to the moon now, germs. You go to the Mars now, germs. You come to the Earth now, germs for 2 billion years. These germs are like us. Vanna, upconscious, ego. They destroyed one another and they almost annihilated there. And then they sat together and said, oh, this won't do. Let us come together. Let us do something for others. Let us have food for all of us in the rainy season. That is where they produced chlorophyll. No scientists produce chlorophyll in this world. Germs produce chlorophyll from the carbon dioxide they inhaled out and the water vapor in the atmosphere and the sun's ultraviolet rays. So you get chlorophyll, and chlorophyll is what makes you survive. Some of them say, I am not a vegetarian, why do you call that a chlorophyll? The animal that you are eating is also living on chlorophyll. Even a fish in the water, big fish eats a smaller fish, smaller fish, smaller fish, smallest fish, smallest fish, smallest fish eats plankton. Plankton is a green leaf under the water. Ultimately it's leaf. And a lot of people come and tell me, no, you are advising people to be vegetarian. Where do they get strength from? They don't get protein. I tell them, come. We have a temple in Kathir, but 2 elephants are there. We have left there. But about 4 elephants in the Krishna temple in Udupi. If any one of you are vegetarians, non-vegetarians, will fight that temple, then I will become a non-vegetarian. It's a pure vegetarian. Pure vegetarian. Nature made it like that. And you should not become a non-vegetarian because you are made to be a vegetarian. Number one. Anyway, that's not our concern now. Our concern is, what did the germs do next? Then the germs said, we can't pass on this world to this germ generation in the future. We must create something more stronger. So they donated one's new DNA, 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 and made the first nucleate itself, the zygote that you and I were in our mother's womb on the first day. So what are you here for? Because the generosity of the germs. So what is your duty? To do something for others. See? It's not that you are doing it out of your generosity. No, it's your compulsion. You are here because of the germs and do something for others to survive in this world. Paropakarartham idam shariram. Did you get that? So between your mouth and your anus, you know, 10 to the power 13 germs, 100,000 billion germs are there. Even if 100 of them are killed by your drugs, your whole immune system changes. You have no appetite for a week when you take one antibiotic. Your stool consistency is different. Now I will not go into all that details. Ultimately, I'll come. Today, children in American hospitals in the ICU get silly infections killing them called superbugs. One of them is called Clostridium difficile, which can't even produce an infection in a rat. But it kills children like flies, they die. There was one professor of pediatrics in Johns Hopkins. There was a Chan, she is Chinese origin, American. This girl was reading a lot of Indian literature. And she found in 17th century India, when a cow gets a severe infection, another cow's cow dung is fed to the cow, and the cow recovers in no time. So one day she took strength in both her hands, courage in both her hands, and said, this child is going to die in another 2 hours' time. I will feed this child. The child's mother shit. So she took 250 ml of shit and emulsified in water, put a rice tube and fed it to the child. Evening the child went home instead. It was gone to heaven, it went home. That is where it started, what is called fecal transplant. And Americans call fecal transplant, we say, hey, this is fruitful. When Morarji Desai was drinking urine, people said, this ass, isn't it? When Morarji went for a press conference in America, he said, sir, you are the prime minister of a country. We are told you drink your own urine. Without batting an eyelid, the old man said, yes, I drink my urine, my own urine. Do you know 20 of your Western medicines are derived from urine? Only difference is you take someone else's urine. I drink my own. The audience gave me a standing ovation. You know, this kind of misconceptions are the best. Go away. One day I was lecturing in London on Indian culture. Somebody was very angry. What culture are you talking about? Silly. You married that girl, you didn't even meet, and you call it culture? You know, everybody is mad. So he was very happy. So I looked like a fool. Then I said, sir, can I ask you a question? He said, go ahead. He was very angry. He said, do you have a child? Of course, what do you mean? I have. Do you love your child, sir? Of course I do. Did you have dating with the child before it became your child? Did you know the child before it became your child? Just like that, I didn't know my wife before I married her. I started loving her after that. Just as you started loving your child after it became your child. Then people stood up and clapped. Then he went away from me. So you should, you know, Morarji Desai, fat came the reply. 20 of your medicines. If you get a heart attack, we give you urokinase. It's from the urine. But only thing is pooled urine. That's not several people's urine. He was using his own urine. It's like, you know, one day one lady, I was in Scotland and I wanted to eat with the hand. That lady was very upset. She said, Dr. Hey, you must use the fork. I said, my hand is open. No, my hand is very dirty. I washed it, my hand is open. Look at it, it's all sterile. What's that fork is for? Sir, to the matter. That fork has gone into several people's mouths. My hand was going into my mouth only. Then she kept quiet. We get enamored, you know, some of our youngsters go there and they say, what do you say? And they go to China and say, the cutty, put the report, they're like, you know, now science tells you, when you eat with your hand, you are transferring the bioenergy to the food. Not only that, science now tells you that if your wife is a good cook and she takes nice chinnamangai sambar, when you go for the meal itself, you must be thinking about the chinnamangai sambar and smell. Then your glands start secreting and you start watering in the mouth. Chima aalajirani. And why ukkandu, you think of the sambar, sambar, sambar. And when the sambar comes, you are ready to purchase it. Ippidi illa. Poyangai namu pottu ippidi kadakada panni. Hot dog, cold turkey, that's why I say Western suffer from malnutrition. Mal, M-A-L. The poor people in the East suffer from malnutrition. Our largest disease is malnutrition in the poor people. And the biggest disease in the West is malnutrition. This is called obesity. Unfortunately, in India now, we are having both. The poor suffer from malnutrition, which is subnutrition, and the rich suffer from malnutrition. And in the next 50 years, India will have more obesity among the richer class of children. Because children don't eat food at home. They want that colored bottle poison. It's very bad. Deadly it is because each bottle contains 8 teaspoons of sugar. Sugar is your poison. That is not a poison. Because, you know, madam was worried about cholesterol. Higher the better. If your cholesterol is high, you have one good certificate saying your liver is functioning so good and absolutely good. And if your liver is functioning good, your whole system is good because liver is your factory to kill all the bad things. Even if you by mistake eat poison, liver has to kill the poison. So, now we come back. What is health? Enthusiasm to work and enthusiasm to compassion. What is disease? When you have a symptom, it is disease. So even if you have a mild symptom, don't ignore it. But go to a doctor who is a humane doctor and tell him, I have a headache, doctor. And if he is a good doctor, and if he is your family doctor, he knows you very well. He says, did you fight with your husband last night? And the lady says, that is exactly what it is. This tension headache. Relax, madam. Tomorrow will be all right. But he went to a specialist. Directly to a 5-star hospital and then say, by the time you say, head, CAT scan is done. Then you say A, another PET scan is done. Then next is MRI done. And all are normal. Then you say, no, neurologically you are fit. Doctor, what is the cause of your pain? I don't know. You go to a psychiatrist. You went to a psychiatrist, you tell him head, and before you say drug, he gives a largactyl. You know what largactyl is? It is derived from moonjoad. Moonjoad is an oil of byproduct of naphtha into petroleum. Moonjoad in Latin means new oil. So Denson Rockefeller, some people did not waste it. So they appointed scientists, quote unquote, and said, find out, can you use it for medicine? So scientists said yes. They got rats injected with adrenaline. Rats started running helter skelter like a mad dog. Injected this moonjoad, rat became a zombie. They said, this is a very good tranquilizer. And that came chlorpromazine, largactyl. And from then on, the SSRIs today all are derived from naphtha. So before you take a pill, find out from your doctor. If I don't take this pill, will I die, doctor? If not, do I have to take it, doctor? There are certain situations where you got to take your pill. Supposing I get malaria. And I don't take the malaria tablet, there's a good chance I'll die. There's a fairly good chance I won't die also, because malaria can be overcome by my own body's immune system. But simply taking a medicine for the heck of it is not a good idea. So if you want to keep your health, keep your doctor at arm's length. But he must be a good doctor. Each one of you must have a doctor. If you don't have your family doctor, you are finished. Both ways you are finished. So have a good family doctor. He is your friend, philosopher and guide. He loves you. He knows you. He even knows your economic standards. Today in pharmacology, we don't teach pharmacoeconomics. A boy sitting in the outpatient department or a specialist sitting there, he doesn't know what he is writing for you. He says you have a bypass surgery, it costs you 10 lakhs. And that 10 lakhs may be ruining your whole family. You may die on the bypass table or you will die, of course, earlier because of the bypass. But your family will be ruined for the rest of their lives. But your family doctor knows your pharmacoeconomics. Family doctor knows your background. Family doctor knows how many cases you got in the Supreme Court against your neighbors. All that he knows, so he knows you in and out. So he will advise you. See, those are the some of the cases. Why are you fighting for 6 inches of the compound wall? You know, we are fighting for 6 inches of the compound wall in the Supreme Court. You don't know the compound wall? A friend of mine is a great tourist. He went to Gotebur. And Gotebur, you see beautiful houses. Fantastic compound wall and fantastic garden because the corporation there reduces the tax if you have a nice garden and a nice compound wall. So they went, saw, appreciating all that. They came to the cemetery. The compound wall was all broken. So he asked the local guide, hey, your municipality which prides in making people have a nice compound wall, can't they make a compound wall for this beautiful cemetery inside which you have beautiful lawns and tombstones from India written, here lies an honest man inside and things like that. Like aid said, sir, it's a very simple sir. Here those who are inside cannot come out. Those who are outside do not want to go in. Why compound wall? So don't build a compound wall around you because you are not I. You are B. Your brother and your neighbor and you are somebody in some place. All you. You, they are part of you. Don't hate them. The minute you hate them, your own cells after some time start hating your own cells. Producing a very horrible disease for which modern medicine has no treatment for autoimmune disease. So friends, universal compassion and hard work. You will not die till the day you die. Thank you.
Thank you. நிறைய லெக்சர் இருக்கு அது
படிக்கிறீங்க members,
okay.
We have only a few announcements for you. See, we are conducting every month the Ganapati Homa on the last Sunday in the morning. It commences around 5:45 and goes till around 7:45. We are looking for volunteers who are prepared to do the Homa on our behalf. The entire funding and the arrangements organizing is being done by the TBSS. Including is being done by the veterans of Tigal, the veterans of Tigal. The very premise. Again, repeat, it's the last Sunday of every month, and that happens to be the subsidy day. And it's being done for the welfare of probably EVS members, for the welfare of humans. Now, those who are desirous of doing so, may please give their names and details to one of the staff of the NYS clinic in practice. Now, we also request people who have carried out this Ganapati Homa in the past. To make it a point to attend this Ganapati Homa, which is being done next as a part of continuing the spirit of doing that. And VBSS is planning on the 5th of September, that is Ganapati Vinayaka Chaturthi, a Homa along with Puja. So it may start around 7 o'clock in the morning. And more details will be available later. So, we'd like you to take part and then take the blessings from the community. And we have a small problem of attendance of members. So, today we find the whole hospital, at times we find 25%, maybe 50%. We are sending messages, SMS to everyone, requesting them to respond back as to whether they will be attending or not. It takes a lot of efforts to send the SMS to you. We request you to at least respond back saying whether you will be attending or not attending so that we could organize things better and also the prasad will be arranged for surprise. Now we have in the last 2014 about 80 members visited the Sringeri Math and had a darshan of His Holiness, had the benefit of his one-to-one communications and handing over prasadam stores, etc. And we want to repeat this in this year, in the month of December. We propose to start it on the 21st of December. We will start by a train leaving for Mangalore from here. And we will be back on the 26th. In this trip, we are planning to cover Mukteshwar, Gokarna, and Kulu. In Gokarna, those who would like to have some people rides done. And we are also trying to organize it with local sub-regals, etc. But then you should give total details if it is possible for us to do. And we want this information within a week's time because the railway booking is about 120 days in advance. And unless we start now, we will not be able to make it up. Unless we have the numbers and people are interested, we will not be able to organize the entire thing and work out it here. And also the cost involved, etc. We have two programs outlined. That is on 28 August 2016, music by Sri Ranganathan of Giri Trading Company, Life Into Your Living. Then we also have on 25th September, our star speaker Dr. Gopalakrishnan of Indian Institute of Heritage and Science will be delivering a lecture at the SSN premises, but then we have not yet decided a topic to be given to him. And we request you, if you have an idea about the type of topic you would like to share thoughts on, to write down and give the same to your office. Members, thank you for your patience and that's it. That's all the announcement I have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let us come back to our Vino Bharati friends. Preeti. Har Har Mahadev!
Har Har Mahadev!
May not once again. Har Har Mahadev! Thank you. I should thank Professor B.L. Mekte. After approaching to him, I was a little skeptic and scared to see him, whether he will accept our invitation. Because thanks to Dr. Ganesh, who happened to be my friend. And he only said that Professor B.L. Mekte is coming to VHS. so I was able to go on with him. And so nice, he came out and received me and telling me that that Master Govind Rao was his teacher. And he was treating me like as if the professor has come. So I must thank my father also, Professor Govind Rao, for having given me this opportunity to bring this giant to this auditorium. On behalf of all of you. Thank you. Professor Govind Rao is my father, he is my teacher, he is my all in all. I learned medicine, philosophy, the human touch from him, and I still think that he is with me. Actually, we had a very good master suddenly affected. There is a new member I joined because previously we had Subramanian, a retired IAS officer, and he migrated to US, but still I communicate with him. No other than Mr. Govind Raja, we call him as Govind. Govind Rikas. And Govi, Govinda, or universal being. And he is a great believer of Ramana and J.K. Krishnamurti. He is giving a lot of translation of, from English to Tamil in TV series, especially the Tamil Discovery channels. And he is also acting in Tamil dramas in Vani Rani and also various writing various books. So ladies and gentlemen, give him a welcome to our community. And we humbly request him to be with us and be our master of ceremonies in the future section also. On behalf of all of you, I request for Sir B.R. McKay to honor him with a small gift of him.
Online.